Welcome to the strip tillage webinar. Today we have, I'd like to welcome to our panel, Steve Peterson from Nifty Ag, based in Illinois, but at the moment Steve is in Kentucky, and I think it's about 9 p.m. In the evening there. I'd also like to welcome Ben Pogiolli from Tillage Solutions in Australia, based in the Atherton Tableland at Tolga, and thanks Ben. And thirdly, Mark Hinderaga from AHR, who's sitting to my left here, representing the Soil Wealth and Integrated Crop Protection Project. So we're very pleased to have Steve and Ben particularly joining us today, who have a wealth of experience in relation to strip till. So thank you very much for agreeing to do that. This webinar is part of the Soil Wealth Integrated Crop Protection Project, funded by the Vegetable Levy with matching funds from the Australian Government and administered by Hort Innovation. The webinar will run for an hour in total. We're looking at about 30 minutes of presentation by Ben and Steve, and they will tag team through the presentation, talking about different aspects of strip till. Then we'll have about 30 minutes or so for questions after that. So please type your questions in as we go, and then I will ask those questions at the end, possibly as we're going through, but more likely at the end in this case. The webinar is being recorded, and the recording will be available to you at the end of the webinar. We'll be sending out a link with that recording, so you'll have all the detail there. I think that's all from me. Thank you, and over to our presenters, Steve Peterson and Ben.
All right, good. I guess it's good morning or good afternoon, whichever it is in Australia. My name is Stephen Peterson. I'm a fourth generation farmer. My family settled our farm in 1877. We primarily have raised corn, soybeans, in a broad acre format. And we currently now work in consulting and manufacturing of equipment. We got into strip till from no-till. We made the big jump from full-till to no-till, and then we wanted to continue that down that path, but had a lot of problems with no-till, and that's how we ended up on strip till, and found a whole wonderful area of advantages. Ben, could you maybe give a little bit of your background?
Okay, basically I'm a farmer on the Atherton Tablelands. We grow pasture seeds, potatoes, peanuts, corn, and sugarcane, and some avocados. Basically got into strip tillage after my father saw a strip till machine down south, and saw the concept, and we basically got into it from there. And could, you know, as soon as we started using the practice of strip till, we could see the advantages of it. And basically the crops that I've strip tilled have been corn on corn, corn behind peanuts, corn into pasture paddocks, and I have done peanuts behind corn on strip till as well. Over to you, Steve.
All right, strip till in the United States has evolved quite a bit. In the Midwest, where I'm primarily located, you guys still got me?
Yep. Strip till in the U.S.
Okay. All right. Can you still hear me?
Yeah.
Excellent.
Okay. I had a little glitch there in the power. I don't know. We're getting a lot of storms over here, so our lights dimmed. In any case, in the Midwest, you know, we started this strip tilling to warm the soils up originally, and then to solve a lot of the problems of no-till, of placement of some of the fertility. So in the U.S., and especially in the broad acre, we really tried to try to solve a lot of the financial issues with broadacre corn and soybeans, as well as increasing production. So talking about the broadacre corn and soybean market, where I'm most have a lot of experience in the U.S. That's kind of where we're at in our Midwest strip till. Ben, I think you can probably talk a little bit about some of the bed top and veggie stuff.
Yep. Gonna go to the next slide. Can we do the next slide, please, Scott? Yep, that's it. So basically, from what we saw in strip tillage in the crops, I guess traditional strip tillage in corn and soybeans and that sort of thing in the US, and what we've done over here in Australia, we looked into different crops that we could use strip tillage on, and there seemed to be a market in sugarcane. So basically, Steve and I got together and come up with some ideas and built a bed top system. So basically, this is some of the work that we've done, and it's in cover crops. So basically, what we're trying to do is go from a cover crop, say straight after sugarcane, work that residue in, slice the stool, then make it, work the soil enough to be able to get in a cover crop behind or a soybean crop behind. And we do it with slicing and pinning of residue, which this machine does. And then basically when we turn around to go back to sugarcane again, we work that cover crop into the ground with this machine and basically make it enough so that planter can get through and plant the crop. And what we're trying to do is, I guess, get soil moisture retention, that sort of thing. This slide's actually taken down in Ingham, doing some work in sugarcane down there. But, I mean, it can work on all different sorts of crops. Steve, do you want to talk about the bed tops over there in the sugarcane that you're using?
Yes. Over here in the States, we've been working in bed tops in Louisiana and in South Texas, in onions and sugarcane and green beans. We've been doing that for our experience has been about 4 or 5 years. What we're seeing in Louisiana is a really tough area to raise sugarcane because it's technically too cold, and it does get rainfall, but it is very tough. A tough climate. And what we originally started doing strip till with was regard to urban encroachment, the burning and all those other things. So as we started the strip till, we did it for one reason, but we found out a host of other things, which is soil health. We started seeing earthworms back in our beds, and we started seeing a tonnage increase on our cane. Typically we were seeing, 35, 37 tons per acre, and we were getting a nice 5 to 7 ton, advantage to strip till in sugarcane. And it's the whole system, the whole biological, the whole circle of life, so to speak, of improving the whole environment to which the crop, is living its and producing and reproducing and growing its crop. So here in the States in bed tops, we're able to clean these water furrows, strip till, pin residue, and get that to start breaking down naturally through microbial actinomycete seed and turning carbon to humus. So that's kind of what we're seeing here in bed tops. I think we could probably go to that next slide, Ben. You think so? We can talk about why we strip till.
Steve, can I just jump in there? It's Gordon, quickly. Just thinking, given that our audience is vegetable growers and agronomists and people interested in vegetables, if you have any examples of when you're talking about these things, vegetables like corn or beans or onions, for example, that'd be of a lot of interest to our audience.
Yeah, okay. Well, basically, on this next slide, and I'll talk a little bit about what we're doing here and what I've learnt when it comes to horticulture crops and basically the results I've seen from strip tillage and different things. So basically we're working this cover crop in. You can see right beside the tractor is our, we've done one pass there. If we want to get that final, we can do two passes, but we don't need to. We only need to get that to a point where we can get the planter for the next crop through the ground and leave that residue on top of the ground as much as we possibly can. So what I basically learned doing strip tillage with corn, a field that I'd worked for probably 5 years, I looked at the soil and it had very, very nice health, and you could tell, you could dig the soil with your hand. It wasn't compacted. Now, we used to grow potatoes and we used to deep rip that, plow it, rotary hoe it, rotary hoe it again, then we'd plant into it. And the reason we did that was so that when we dig, harvest the potatoes, we don't get lumps and we don't get bruising on the crop.
It looks like we lost Ben there for a bit.
We've just...
Yeah.
Ben, are you back? Are you still there, Ben?
Basically, we... I found there was no lumps. I've never had the opportunity to put it into full practice. I really like to try because the soil just gets so better. You guys still hear me there?
Yeah, you're just dropping in and out a bit, Ben. So we got most of that, but we didn't get all of it.
Okay. Would you like just, me to run over it again?
Well, I've got a question actually. While I've got you here, there's a I'm wondering if you could just clarify what you mean by bed tops when you're talking about strip till bed tops. I've just got a question asking for a bit of clarification on that, either okay, Steve or Ben.
Yeah, okay. It's so basically we traditionally strip till on flat ground. So basically go behind a corn crop and strip till. We don't have raised beds as such. So we're talking like a bed that's 1,800 wide. Or even raised bed, even you could have two hills on that 1,800 bed as such, or you could, yeah, it could be just the one, and it doesn't have, that's not a specific measurement. You could do it for any bed top crop. You can basically configure the machine to suit that crop, and it's the principle of, I guess, moving residue to where you need it to be able to get that planter through and let it build soil health.
Yeah, and I think you know, when we're talking about beds, you know, like for instance, you know, in Imperial Valley in California, where we're strip tilling, we may be strip tilling quasi using a term called rejuvenating the old bed, where we're coming from maybe sweet corn. Or onions, broccoli. There's really not a crop that you can't strip till. It's a very easy transition from a full till or a full 6, 7, 9 passes to pull up a new bed. You know, you can cut a lot of time to switch your bed over to the next crop because you're just, you know, you're rejuvenating it through the strip till practice, the theory of strip till. Does that make sense, Ben?
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. So it's just basically that exactly what you said, Steve. A practice of, you know, rejuvenating beds without ripping them down and ploughing them and rotarying them and all that sort of stuff, destroying soil structure.
Now the next slide is why we're trying to rejuvenate the bed, or why we're trying to save the bed, or why we're trying to strip them. And the next slide is getting into the meat and potatoes, so to speak. What we're really trying to do is to do a proper placement of your inputs, whether it's a micronutrient package or your N, P, and K, whether it be dry or liquid or whatever. Strip till can handle any of those different commodities. But what we're trying to do is effectively, efficiently place all our nutrients in a bed, in a strip, where it has the highest concentration, so it won't be diluted or translocated through either flooding or wind or broadcast or flood irrigation down the water flows. So what we're trying to do is take the very high cost of inputs and manage those in a way that not only it makes more sense financially, but it makes much, much more sense to the crop. The crop sees this wonderful, happy, fertile, lack of compaction. It has a really beautiful area to grow in. And so we're able to reduce the amount of input cost fertilizers and not risk our translocations out the gate or on the Great Barrier Reef, whichever the case may be. In Florida, it's out in the Gulf of Mexico. And we're trying to really manage that part of our crop to that best benefits the crop. I think, Ben, you could probably talk about the soil conservation a little bit.
Yeah, I'll just before I get to that, Steve, I'll just talk about the cost savings. I mean, these machines we're running at anywhere from 10 to 16 kilometres an hour, depending on what I guess your ground is like, and very, very easy to pull the bed top stuff. So use minimal fuel compared to what we would do with, you know, a plow, a ripper, and a rotary hoe. So I guess with the soil conservation stuff, we've seen, you know, like I've got fields that used to get washed a lot, and by leaving that residue on top, and I'm traditionally was a conventional tillage farmer. We don't do a lot of no-till in this area, I mean, we got fields that should get massive wash in a big downpour that we're not getting now. You know, we're getting no soil running off that field, and yet we're finding when we do strip till that you basically get, so if you get 70 mil of rain, say, on a block. It doesn't get that wash like we used to get in that field. You know, in a short time, I'm talking 70 mil an hour. And basically, when you go to the next step where you get smaller rain events, you seem to be getting more moisture in that strip because it's more open. So if you were to get, say, 2 inches or 50 mil of rain, it would be like getting 75 mil in that zone, and that's something we've found in work we've done in Central Queensland with guys tripling down there. They find they're getting fewer rain events but heavier rain events. And guy was talking to me and he said they had 75 mil of rain, and basically underneath their no-till fields they would have moisture down about 50 to 75 mil, but in that zone where they strip tilled, they had a full profile of moisture. So this is fields that are side by side, no till, strip till. So that was interesting to see that they're getting a lot more water infiltration out of strip till than they are out of no till.
Do you, Steve? Do you think that's because you're getting better water infiltration down into that strip till area and getting runoff in the other blocks, or?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. So it's the water just cannot penetrate the no-till stuff. It can strip till because it's so fluffy and yeah, it's just so much easier for the water to infiltrate it.
Yep.
And I do believe that because in a broadacre situation, you've basically got conventional till and no-till in the same field. So where it would run off the no-till, which is your intro, it then gets into the conventional till, which is your strip.
Hmm.
I think that has a bit to do with it too.
So it's actually concentrating the water, like it's flowing into the into the strip till zone, and then infiltrating down through that area.
Yeah. Which traditionally strip till in the US was a lot of the time used to dry soil and heat soil up. But if you do it at the right time in Australia, even in a broadacre application, you can actually conserve moisture. I mean, if you do it at the wrong time, yes, you could lose moisture, but you've got to have a plan when you do it, and you've got to do it at the right time. Using common sense on that front, I guess. So you would want to run right behind a harvester if you were broadacre and you're going to strip till. So that any rain events you got after that, you would conserve any of that moisture.
Yep.
We want to go to the next slide? You can talk on this, Steve. We still have Steve there?
Steve. Good mic.
It's unmute.
You might want to unmute your microphone, Steve.
Steve, if you can hear us, I think your mic might be muted, and I don't think we can unmute it from here.
Anyways, I can talk on this.
Okay. Thanks, Ben.
So basically, fewer passes. So what we used to do, I guess, in our corn peanut rotation, we would come in and diss that field, then basically rip it, maybe plough it, maybe rip it twice. Then we'd come behind with a power harrow and work that soil down so that we could go and plant our corn or peanuts, whatever we're doing. So now we're basically just running the strip till over. So I can do about 3.2 hectares, about three hectares an hour, and good going. And I'm only using that tractor probably burning 40 litres an hour to do that, compared to, you know, using that same, not getting, using implements not as wide as what I'm using, so I'm on a 5.4 metres, all six-row equipment, and, you know, burning a lot more fuel than that. So we've had massive savings in labour, fuel, and even wear and tear on machinery. I mean, machines are getting more expensive, and basically you can't afford to wear them out.
Ben, also, can you still hear me?
Yeah, got you back, Steve.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, I just wanted to add, about the being able to increase that organic matter into that soil, and how the water retention becomes much greater as the more and more you strip till, and allows the soil biology and the soil health and the organic matter to all raise in the right direction at the same time that we're spending less money to do this and we're raising better crops. But I know we had a little storm there and I lost my signal, but I just wanted to touch base real quick on how it's very important to continue to raise that organic matter and get that soil, that soil health and the biology and the microbes active in your beds and in your broad acres to help, you know, conserve moisture and decrease the chance of compaction and some of those things. But go ahead and finish your thought there, Ben.
Yeah. Thanks, Steve. So yeah, basically we're using a lot fewer machines now to do the get the job done, and I'm also using less horsepower tractors. So where we'd use a 270 horsepower tractor to do most of our conventional tillage work, we're down to like a 200 horsepower tractor now to strip till with. And I guess a lot of guys that I talk to about strip tillage, and a lot of this is in broad acre, but it's also applicable to horticulture, is the increased timeliness of seeding. So you can basically come out of one crop and turn it around very fast because of the less passes you're doing on that field. Basically out with one crop, in normal strip till, we just strip till at once, go through, drop your nutrients in the ground. And then with horticulture, you might run over that bed twice with that machine. But because it's so fast, it takes you no time to turn it around. Basically, you know, you can go from 24 hours of having a crop standing in a field to having another crop right behind that. Do you want to talk a little bit, Steve, about what you're seeing with guys with conventional and no-till and the cost on that?
The biggest thing is the ability to implement this system into your own program. It's not a set rule book. It can be fit in there to any kind of raised bed, veggie, onion crop of whatever you're trying to raise. The thing is just get that step going to get that soil health and get the placement and do your soil tests and your agronomy, but at the same time, you know, be very mindful you're reducing your passes, you know, you're improving your soil biology and your soil health, and you're going to raise your production at the same time. You're going to be lowering your input costs, and your soil is going to become more alive and more reactive to the positive things that you're doing to it because of the increased efficiencies of what you're placing where, when, and how. And those are really four or five things there that are going to be hard to get your head wrapped around, but it's where you're placing it, when you're placing it, and how you're placing it is the really very simple things that you can achieve through just a very beginning step into strip till. I think, Ben, you know, I've told you about some of the big farmers that we do custom work with around here. Some farmers, some of these big families, half strip till, half don't. And the broad acre guys or the full till guys have a ceiling that is a 30% lower than as you implement this strip till program because of all the other new benefits that we're getting and we're finding out through trials and university trials. So I think that's what I wanted to hit on real quick right there. Ben, can you explain how your planter kind of rides on its own strips and what you're seeing when you're strip tilling on your farm?
Yeah, so basically because I'm not no-till, it's always conventional till, so planter ride was always pretty good, but I can see the difference between planter ride on a no-till field to a strip-till field. Like it's like planting on conventional till, but I'm getting the moisture retention in those fields, which is a huge thing for me. Even though we live in the wet tropics, we have such a free-draining soil that we need. I still need to conserve as much moisture as we can for crops, and I lease a lot of country to grow corn and peanuts on, and they've got no irrigation, so I've got to conserve every ounce of moisture that I possibly can. And you know, I did look at no-till, I guess, in the beginning as a way to conserve moisture, but we can do it just as well, but we get a better planter ride, so we get better seed spacing. I mean, with better seed spacing, you get better yields in these crops.
Hmm.
So do we want to go to the next slide?
I'm getting a few questions coming in now, so but I might just leave those till the end, Steve and Ben, if that's okay, because we're sort of getting close to that point.
Steve, do you want to talk about planning on trips, Steve, over in the US?
One more time, Ben. I didn't hear you.
Do you want to talk about planning on strips over in the US? How you do it?
Yeah, over here we're using a lot of narrow and wide based. We get as wide as 60 feet here, multiple units, but we are using some RTK technology. It's not necessary. It's not needed. As long as you're near the strip, you don't have to be dead center on the strip. But we do need to be somewhere near, you know, that strip. It is, you know, the roots will find its way to the placement of the NP and K. We think the depth of the fertility placement so far doesn't really matter which crop, whether, you know, be some of the sugar cane or some of the other crops, onions. This four to six inches. 4 to 7 inches seems to be about the sweet spot to as an overview of where we need to start looking at placement of our fertility. You know, there are some studies of deep placement of this and that and the other thing, but we need to get a first step, get to strip tilling, and there is certainly trials of strip tilling with some lime, some calcium, raising the pH. So all those things make this little strip, this little home that this crop's going to live in for the next 3, 6, 9 months, whatever it is. We're really trying to make that a happy home. And what we're finding is we're actually increasing our soil tests for nutrients and biological life and organic matter. And we're actually reducing the amount of trips and our input cost to get it. So it's a very exciting time to be strip tilling right now, because we actually have the technology now to really replicate our passes over and over and over, year after year after year. And we're able to log that and back it up with soil tests, which, you know, in the last 10 years have really have helped. To base what we kind of thought it always was, but we didn't know. And now we've got some exciting trials going on right now that are showing some very, very large increases in production and some pretty steep declines in production costs. So that's kind of what we're seeing here in the States. I think, Ben, I think we, you know, we've talked about in Australia, you know, about the runoff. You know, from the Burdekin and some of the other areas that you know, strip till does help the translocation of nutrients. Will you agree with that?
Yeah. And I guess this field here on this next slide, there's a classic example. It's on some reasonably steep country. It's contoured. It's been strip till 8 years, I think, corn on corn. We had a big rain event last year. Basically, I think we got about 100 mil in an hour. And there was a lot of water came down from above me. This is in Tolga on the Red Tor. Now, this field would have normally had a lot of erosion in it if we weren't strip tilling. We got near on zero erosion out of that field. The only place we did get a little bit of erosion was where the silt from farms above me basically blocked the drain, and the water flowed into my property, and basically nothing would save it on that corner where I had runoff from above me, basically. But the soil health, and then this is a field that is getting better soil health, but we've got no irrigation. This is a place I'd really love to grow potatoes, to see whether my theory that the soil getting better, we don't need to rotary hoe. I think the only reason we use a rotary hoe is because we first used the rotary hoe in the first place. And it just started to cause problems right from there. I think if we did less to the soil in the way of trying to turn it into something with maximum tillage, I think we'd be better off. That's my thoughts on it anyway. And that's in all crops, whether it be lettuce, whatever, you know, and it comes from the benefits of what I saw out of this field that led me to look at other crops that we could use strip tillage in. Because I think any crop can be strip tilled. Some tougher than others, but it can be done.
Okay. Are we at the point now where we can, Ben and Steve, where you'd be able to field a few questions? Okay, thank you. Well, I might start with Mark. Mark has one to start off with, and then I'll come back with some others that people have been asking as you've been talking. So, Mark.
Yeah, maybe I'll ask Steve if you have some just general quick advice for someone that's just starting out into strip tillage. Do you have a comment or two to some heads up or watch out type comments?
Basically, it's the KISS mentality. Keep it simple, stupid. Don't try to outthink yourself. Don't try to out-trick yourself. It still is soil. I've strip-tilled in many different countries and in about 30 of the 48 states here. And it's still dirt. And it's not as hard as it can be made out to by maybe a neighbor, but it's common sense, and it starts with just getting started and fellowship with fellow strip tillers. That's probably the biggest thing I could say is what we try to do is get fellow strip tillers together with other fellow strip tillers on the phone and exchange phone numbers and pick up the phone and call people. That's my biggest thing that I can help people to get started is to just common sense, find some mates that are doing it and establish that.
Yeah. Can I just add something to that, Mark?
Yeah, go ahead.
So basically, when someone gets into strip tillage, and I've been through this myself, you're going to go, you're not going to understand that you can just do it in one pass. When I started, I always thought, well, I should really disc the top so that it'll do a nicer job if I disc the top, it'll level everything out. It actually did a worse job. So the less I did before strip tillage, the better result you get out of it. And it took me a couple of years to actually convince myself that I was wasting my time by discing that field or doing something to that field before I went and strip-tilled it. And the less you do before you strip-till, the better off you are.
And does that include mulching, Ben? Like, would you consider mulching the stubble up a bit?
I don't always mulch. Depending on what you're trying to do behind, you've got to have a plan. You've got to ask yourself the question, why am I doing this job? And if it's just to make yourself feel better, well, you might as well leave the mulcher in the shed and just go and strip till. But if you have a valid reason to mulch beforehand, well, that's a different story.
Great. Thanks, Ben. Thanks, Ben and Steve.
And that Steve? Mulching, you know, let's be very clear on that mulching. The negatives of the mulching is you're actually putting the residue mixed within the strip now. And as that mulch breaks down, it breaks down into a noxious gas for emergence, you know, and carbon dioxide and some of the other nasty things about emergence. So actually having that mulch in the strip is very less desirable than going into the paddock and making your strip and having all the residue on both sides. So mulching is not necessarily a good thing at all. Ben, I think you'll probably agree with that.
Yes, yeah. I would. Mm-hmm. You would only do it if you had, say, a grass problem or say, yeah, some issue that you had to try and fix without. You had no other option but to mulch. I guess that's what you got to look at. If you only do it unless you've got no other option. Otherwise, you just don't bother doing nothing before strip till.
Hmm. Okay, thanks, Ben and Steve, for those answers. Now, I've got a question from Peter. Assuming I guess this is to Ben, that you've been talking about in North Queensland, sort of heavy to medium clay soils. Do you have any examples of strip till on lighter soils?
Yeah, basically on sand. We've done sand, clays. I mean, not right here at my place, but we have strip tilled to all different soil types. I mean, it doesn't really matter what soil type you're on. It's basically just tweaking the machine and setting the machine up to what soil type it needs to suit. It works on all soil types.
Okay.
Okay. So another question probably for Ben is, how important is soil moisture right at the time you're strip tilling? As in, can it be too wet and can sidewall compaction and them type of things? Or too dry?
You can get some sidewall smearing depending on what shank you're running in that strip till. There's many different options of different shanks that you can run to alleviate that. But it's like any job. It's got its best time to do it. And if you can stay in that window of the right moisture, yes, it does make a difference to the job you get out the back of the machine.
Yeah. And the right moisture
Also, you know, you got to define what when are we going to strip till? Are we going to strip till right in front of the seeder or the planter? Obviously, if you're going to strip till, you know, a day or a week in front of that planter or seeder, yes, soil moisture, you know, it has to be fit. Now, if you've got 3 to 5 months ahead of that, here in the States, we've got this thing called winter and frozen ground and mud and awful conditions. So we do strip till in, you know, 3 to 5 inches of frost as well as mud. But we do have a winter that will fix a lot of problems. So I think, you know, when you're talking about can it be too wet, it just depends on when you're going to be running on top of that with your planter and base your decision on soil moisture. And if it's too wet or too dry on that.
Yep. Excellent. Thank you.
And in the States, Steve, you don't often use any sort of basket behind your strip tools because you're using the snow melt to melt that down and get that sorted out for when you plant in the spring. We're in Australia, we're different. We don't get much snow here, and we've basically got to force the soil, I guess, to crumble a little bit. So that's why we'll basically run a basket behind strip tools in Australia to help, I guess, just crumble that soil down so that it's a perfect seed bed when we need to plant.
Thanks, Ben. I've got a question from Anna about GPS. How important is having GPS capability in strip tilling? Probably for Steve, maybe.
Yeah, guys, repeat that one more time. You kind of broke up.
Oh, so a question from Anna. How important is GPS capability in strip till?
You know, that's excellent. Excellent question. It's not needed. It doesn't have to be. If you're a good operator and you can steer your tractor and that's what the steering wheel is for, you don't have to have a $10,000 or $20,000 RTK GPS. You can steer that with markers, mechanical markers, or by rows, and you can be fine. You can get along fine with that. Does it make it easier with GPS? Well, sure. Does it make it even better with RTK? Well, sure. But is it absolute necessary? No, absolutely not. You will have to drive it. And you'll have to be aware and pay attention. But absolutely, you can do that without GPS.
Hmm.
Also on bed tops, like if you've got beds there already, it's even easier to it's less relevant, Stephen. And if you've got top and you've got wheelbarrows to follow, it's not needed.
And you want to make sure you're selecting gear that does give you a little bit of a cushion. You know, if you need a nice, you know, 3 or 4 inch, you know, strip, you know, you might want to make sure you got a machine that'll give you a little bit of cushion, an 8 or a 9 inch wide strip to give you a little room to move left or right. But yeah, I agree with Ben, what he says. Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. I've got a couple of questions from Peter and from Anna. I'm going to try to combine those. With say corn or pearl millet, do you need to slash to break down that heavy stalk material before tilling? And the other question is in relation to weeds and you know, what impact do weeds have on strip till? So maybe those together.
First of all, I'm going to jump in here. Chopping corn heads, any way to cut or put marks into any of this residue will allow the biological life, the actinomycete, to enter the carbon and to start breaking that down through natural process in humans. So it is not necessarily needed to make a pass to slice and dice. It just needs to have some sort of entry point for either the natural degradation of carbon to humus to start the process. And
okay,
can you add to that?
I didn't hear that question, Mark. So I didn't hear the question, sorry.
The question was about weeds, about the impact of heavy stalk remaining from say corn and or pearl millet before strip tilling. How does that impact on strip till, and what about weeds? What impact do they have?
I mean, weeds aren't hard to get rid of. I mean, I basically just use chemicals to look after any weeds and the stalk, yeah. The reef, had an issue with it to get the strip till through, never. I mean, Steve, you saw that field that we were in. We had Corn Lodge 1 year on us and we lost some of it. And basically we had full plants laying on the ground and we could get through it, no worries at all. So no, you've got to pick, you know, you've got to have the machine set up to do the job, I guess.
Yep. Okay. We've got a couple of questions about hilling. What about crops like potatoes where you've got a hill? Is there a place for strip till in those sort of crops?
Yes, absolutely. It's something, especially if you're running a big bed. I think, like how we conventionally used to grow potatoes was on two hills that were 914 apart. If you did it on a full bed, I think it'd be easier even again to do it. Okay.
Strip tilling basically can get down as tight as 15 inch. I don't know what the term is in Australia, but for crop spacing, we can handle, most people generally can strip till 15 to 20 inches and then out from there. 15 is about as tight as you get to really handle the residue and properly make your strip for the next crop. 15 inches is get pretty tight. Agree, Ben?
Yeah. And to get into those vegetable crops, you've got to basically here, I guess we've done so much tillage over the years, it did take us a little while to get that soil structure back again that we could actually, you would actually be able to grow crops in there. So you've got to have that organic matter and everything in that soil. And once you get to that point, well, you basically never have to roadshow, that's all again.
I've got a couple of questions now from David. And one you might have already answered. The first part is, what is the minimum width of a strip which can be tilled? And the second part of that question is there a ripper shank that can be pulled through the strip? So width of the strip and ripping.
You want to answer that, Steve?
Well, strip till is not chisel plowing. Some people still like to try to hang on to that full till mentality. But it is not deep 15, 20, 30 inch ripping. It is strip tilling. It is preparing for the next crop, you know, at a normal depth of, like we were talking earlier in this conversation, you know, 4 to 8 inches deep. And I think that's, you know, that's where we really need to keep that conversation. As far as width, 15 inch row spacing is about as tight as you can strip till. 20 inches is easier than 15. 30 inches is easier than 20. But with the wide array of shanks and points and some of those things, we've really been able to handle a lot of different things thrown at us with regards to the width of strip. And as long as we've got a decent width, a nice 6, 7, 8 inch wide strip, depending on the residue mat, I think those are all a doable strip till practices that can be replicated year in, year out. Ben, would you agree?
Yeah. And with
stripper wheat, for instance, like with stripper wheat. I don't know if you guys got stripper wheat, but stripper wheat can be really hard to strip till in because of the way that mat runs. And you've just got to be really aware of the gear that you're going to select to be able to strip till in those narrow row requirements. Sorry, Ben, I didn't mean to interrupt you.
Yeah, you're right, Steve. So basically, with wheat, we've run behind a harvester. This field was on basically controlled traffic. And so we ran in the heaviest part of that field. It was irrigated wheat. We didn't have any issues running behind that harvester. So basically, the spreader wouldn't spread the full width of the front or the head, you'd call it, Steve. Yeah, and we ran straight behind there, and it was a heavy amount of residue, and we could get through it, no worries at all. So I don't think stripper wheat would be an issue to strip till.
Okay. I've got a couple of questions about small seeded crops, one from Donna and one from Peter. So small seeded vegetable crops like onions and carrots, for example, and then particularly if you have high levels of residue, do you have any experience with those sort of crops? And if so, do you think they're suitable for strip till?
I guess it depends on what row spacing you're on, if you're on a bed top. You can work that into the bed, I guess. You can sweep it off top of the bed. I mean, you can pretty much do anything. We can clean the whole top of a bed off if you need to get in there quick and give that some light vertical tillage. And it's true vertical tillage. It doesn't have any angle on the blades at all. Or if you're planting it in rows on the flat, we can also, it's just about clearing that strip or managing that residue. So it is possible to do any of those crops. You agree, Steve?
I do. And I think, you know, when you're talking about that very, very small seed size, such as carrots and onions, I think then one needs to work out this, you know, when you're talking about rejuvenation of the strip and strip tillage, we do enter into what you did mention, you know, sweeping the top of that bed off and still doing a light vertical till and a nutrient placement without having, you know, to deal with the concerns of having that small seed mixed in with the residue, because you know that is a very important factor, at least in, you know, our experience. You know, a lot of the growers with onions and carrots are very concerned about having residue around that delicate seed, and so in that particular application, you know, I would, you know, we typically over here, we do sweep the top off and then do a light vertical till and get the bed rejuvenated and put the nutrient package back into the top in one pass. So that still still works into our strip till theory and our program.
Okay, thank you. We're getting pretty close to the end. Probably got time for one more question. There's a question from Adam about fertilizer and acidification. If you're putting your fertilizer, banding fertilizer in the same, down the same strip all the time, are you liable to come up with some problems like acidification or any other problems related to that?
Well, you got to remember, as we're strip tilling, you know, we are finding that we're adding 30 to 50% less P&K in these strips. So as we strip till, we're learning that we need less to raise more and to maintain our fertility. And as we're working with soil biology and biological additives, we are able to help deter those things that theoretically could happen. But we are actually getting away from that. And as I've said before earlier, that we can add calcium to the strip till. So as we can add a little bit of calcium to that strip to prevent any of those things to happen. And a little bit of calcium in the strip can go a long way. Ben?
So basically it depends on what crop you're growing, again, to what your options are, I guess, with doing things. So basically, when I do peanuts don't like a band of fertilizer. They like nutrients in that zone. They're like they're good scavengers of nutrients. So I tend to I won't put it underneath with the shank. I'll actually drop it basically in front of the shank and work it into that top profile of the soil. Can drop some in a little bit in behind the shank, so I get it mixed right through the zone. And there's no reason you have to stay on that same strip every year. Sometimes I'll strip till basically on the intro, depending on what I want to do. If I've got standing corn stubble, sometimes it's easier to leave it where it's standing and go on the intro and basically strip till in there. And in that case, that whole field's getting worked every 2 years. It's having some sort of form of tillage through that field. You can adapt it to whatever you need it to do. It's not just the one system, I guess. You work out what your issues are and you work out how you fix those problems with it.
Okay. All right. Thanks, Ben and Steve. And I think we're going to have to wrap it up there. We're just about coming up to the hour. There are a few other questions we haven't quite got to. Teresa was asking about, more scientific evidence or scientific information that's now becoming available, and could she get access to that? We might follow that up later. Thanks, Teresa, for that question. David, in relation to the lettuce, has come back and said he's looking at four rows on a 1.4 metre bed, so I guess that's getting a bit of a squeeze. But we'll come back to any of the questions we haven't answered individually, so thank you for them. I'd just like to thank Steve, both Steve and Ben, for giving us your time and experience, over 20 years of experience in the practical application of strip till has been fabulous, and I'm sure the rest of the people who have been listening to your webinar would agree that it's been very valuable, and thank you very much for giving us your time. Thanks to Mark for organising Ben and Steve to be here and to run present this webinar with us. It's been really good. I'd like to just acknowledge again that this is part of the Soil Wealth Integrated Crop Protection Project, and acknowledge the Vegetable Levy and Hort Innovation for the funding. The recording of this webinar will be available probably this afternoon, if not tomorrow, and we will send the link out to everyone who registered for that so that you can listen to it again. And please feel free to forward that on to anyone else who you think might be interested in that. For more information, I would encourage you to contact Mark sitting here, and I think you probably have Mark's contact information from the invitations and registration information that went out, but his email address is mark@ahr.com.au. And that's all from me, I think. And I'd just like to thank the presenters particularly, and also thank the participants who took the time to join us. Thank you.
Thanks, Ben. Thanks, Steve.
God bless you guys.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.